Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today for our Edward P. Evans Seminar in Myelodysplastic Syndrome. This is an endowed seminar that was made possible by a generous gift from the Edward P. Evans Foundation that also established our Edward P. Evans Center for MDS at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. Mr. Evans founded the foundation to support transformational and collaborative medical research in MDS because as a patient, he became frustrated with the siloed nature of work on this disease. We're proud to honor Mr. Evans today by hosting this virtual seminar, which includes researchers and clinicians at all levels across several institutions. We're very pleased that trustees and leaders from the foundation are also joining us today. And so on behalf of the Dana-Farber community, thank you all for attending. Before we start our program, a couple housekeeping notes. All attendees are on mute and their video is turned off just to ensure that everyone can adequately hear the program. And if you have questions during the seminar, please use the Q&A icon at the bottom of your screen to submit them as we go along. We'll have some time to address as many of these questions as possible after the talk. So now I'm pleased to introduce our speaker for today's program, Dr. Jennifer Trowbridge. Dr. Trowbridge received a PhD from the University of Western Ontario in 2006 and completed her postdoctoral training with Stu Orkin here in Boston, where she studied the role of DNMT1 in HSC biology and leukemia stem cell function. She then started her lab at the Jackson Laboratory on Mount Desert Island, where she is an associate professor and has been there since 2012. Dr. Trowbridge's research interests span aging, hematopoiesis, and cancer biology, and the current focus of her lab is on how cell intrinsic and cell extrinsic processes influence HSC dysfunction in age-related clonal hematopoiesis and myeloid malignancies. And she created a knock-in mouse model of the DNMT3A hotspot mutation, which is now widely used in studies focused on clonal hematopoiesis, MDS, and AML. She has received an Edward P. Evans Foundation Discovery Research Grant in 2020, is a scholar of the Leukemia Lymphoma Society and a recipient of the Janet Rowley Award for from the International Society for Experimental Hematology, among other awards and accolades. Dr. Trowbridge is a friend and collaborator to many of us here at Dana-Farber, and she's known not only for her deep expertise in the field of HSC biology, but for her collegiality and generosity. And so it's I'm pleased to welcome you, Jennifer Trowbridge, for your talk today. So we're looking forward to hearing it.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Dr. Lindsley. And it's a pleasure to be here and to be speaking with all of you about the work, recent work that's been happening in my lab. So I'm gonna start with the why. Why have we been embarking on this endeavor? And this is really the reason that there's a global increase in lifespan, and this is only increasing. So this graph shows the proportion of population age 60 years or older in 2015 and projected out to 2050, where you can see the darkest shaded countries represent areas in which 30% or more of the population will be age 60 years or older. Now, this is a very good thing, obviously. However, the challenge in managing an aging population is really the challenge of health span and limits on health span. So this graph depicts the difference between health span and lifespan in the US population. So here, health span is defined as the average age at which you're free of chronic disease that represent the leading causes of death in elderly populations in the US. So this includes diseases like type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and cancer. So if you imagine with an increase in the age of our population, we're increasing the number of individuals that are susceptible to these conditions and diseases. And the goal really is to be able to increase health span along with lifespan to narrow that delta, narrow the gap between years of life in which you remain healthy versus lifespan. So with respect to the hematopoietic and immune systems, how health span is really defined is by healthy function of our immune and blood systems. So with aging, there is a well-known, well-characterized decline in immune system function, antibody production, response to vaccination, and in very elderly populations, anemia. On the other side, there's an increased risk of diseases and disorders, including myelodysplastic syndrome and myeloid malignancies like acute myeloid leukemia. And that's really highlighted on the bottom in these incidence graphs. So these are really highly aging associated diseases and conditions. So while many of these conditions are really manifest at the level of these mature populations shown at the bottom, erythroid, myeloid, and lymphoid, and as I just mentioned, with aging, there's reduction in red blood cell production, decrease in repertoire of B and T lymphocytes, and a bias in the hematopoietic system toward production of myeloid cell types that's correlated with susceptibility to AML. That many of these alterations, in fact, are predisposed at the level of hematopoietic stem cells in the context of aging. So within the hematopoietic stem cell population, there's an expansion of phenotypic or cell surface marker defined hematopoietic stem cells. However, they have a reduced functionality. So there's a reduction in homing and ability to regenerate upon transplantation, as well as a myeloid lineage bias that's been very well characterized across many groups in the context of hematopoietic stem cell aging, particularly in using mouse models. Now, hematopoietic aging can certainly manifest at the level of hematopoietic stem cells, but also at the level of long-lived progenitor cells that contribute to hematopoiesis. And this includes work from our lab showing that there's a decrease in lymphoid-primed multipotent progenitors in the context of aging, and that these lymphoid-primed progenitors have a molecular shift toward myeloid-biased transcription and myeloid-biased cell production with aging. So when we think about taking a step back to what I talked to you about and with respect to lifespan versus health span, the goal in our lab and with this work that I'll talk to you about today is really to think about how to extend health span of the hematopoietic system. And we see this really as there's two key components. The first is to be able to improve regenerative function and limit myeloid bias of aged hematopoietic stem and progenitor cells. But also when you consider that cancer is one of the major factors that define health span, we also need to think about at the same time how we might prevent blood cancers and what I'll talk to you today about is more specific to myeloid malignancies from being initiated within these cellular compartments. So from within hematopoietic stem and progenitor cells. So the way I've structured my talk today is to really talk about these two central areas or themes. And I'll start with the first, which is with respect to improving functionality of hematopoietic stem and progenitor cells in the context of aging. And then later on, I'll move to the second part. So when we first embarked on these studies in my lab, we started out with this kind of high-level central question of when and how does hematopoietic stem cell function decline? And the reason that we couldn't answer this based on the literature is that there are a lot of studies that have been done on hematopoietic stem cell aging have taken the approach of a more binary comparison between young and aged individuals, young and aged mice. So as shown down here in the bottom, comparing, for example, a mature adult mouse of 2 to 3 months of age to old mice that are 18 to 24 months of age. Now, when you do a binary comparison like that, there are many, many mechanisms and processes that you can find that are distinct between young and old hematopoietic stem cells. What that doesn't tell you is whether there was a particular order in which those changes were acquired, what are initiating events versus events that happen later on, and really what are some of the initial causes that seed decline in hematopoietic stem cell function, and at what age does that occur? So to be able to answer those questions in more detail, we decided to use an approach and take a cross-sectional study in using mice, and this is using C57 Black 6 mice. And we looked by profiling various ages of animals, all the way from young through to old. We looked for hallmarks of hematopoietic and hematopoietic stem cell aging. So shown here is this phenotype of myeloid-biased hematopoiesis, which I have already described. So this is really looking in the peripheral blood at the proportion of myeloid cells relative to other cell types. And you can see that while this is clearly an aging phenotype, this phenotype emerges significantly by mouse middle age, which here is shown as 9 to 12 months of age in these animals. So at the same age, middle age in mice, we can observe many of the phenotypes that have been associated with hematopoietic stem cell aging, which includes a phenotypic long-term hematopoietic stem cell expansion, as I told you. And other phenotypes, I'm showing one here, which is accumulation of gamma H2AX foci within the hematopoietic stem cells themselves. This is pretty well described to be a hematopoietic stem cell aging phenotype. And here we're showing that this emerges significantly by middle age in these animals. So we then wanted to understand at middle age with regard to these phenotypes, whether these were fundamentally due to changes that had occurred in the hematopoietic stem cell population that were not reversible, so hematopoietic stem cell intrinsic, centrally intrinsic changes, or whether these were alterations that were driven by changes in the bone marrow microenvironment where these hematopoietic stem cells reside. So it's well known that hematopoietic stem cells are influenced by many things in their environment. So this includes direct cell-cell contact with other cell types, as well as factors that are produced or secreted by cell types in the environment, including, as shown here, a stem cell factor, which is kind of the canonical of stem cell growth factor. So we thought that this was a really fundamentally important question to understand in order to get at the mechanism by which hematopoietic stem cells start to change and accrue aging phenotypes at middle age. So in order to approach this, we set up a reciprocal transplantation strategy where we could take hematopoietic stem cells from young mice and transplant them into middle-aged environments, so transplant them into middle-aged recipients, or vice versa, to take purified hematopoietic stem cells from middle-aged mice and transfer them back into a young recipient or young bone marrow microenvironment and look at functionality. So I'm gonna show you two of the sort of most relevant phenotypes, the first being their overall regenerative capacity, which here is measured by chimerism in the peripheral blood. And on the right is in terms of the myeloid bias hematopoiesis, which, as I told you, is sort of a aging hallmark on the right. So you can see that if you just look at the controls, so at the bottom, the young into young or middle-aged into middle-aged, there is clearly, you can recapitulate what's been observed in aging previously, which is impaired regenerative capacity of middle-aged stem cells in a middle-aged environment, as well as myeloid bias, as shown here on the right, middle-aged stem cells in a middle-aged environment. If you now modulate the age of the environment, you can see that when you transplant young stem cells into a middle-aged recipient mouse, the overall regenerative capacity is similar. So that doesn't significantly change, but there is a significant myeloid bias in the hematopoietic cells that are produced in the peripheral blood. And when you take a middle-aged hematopoietic stem cell and return it back into a young recipient or young environment, you can see restore regenerative capacity and reduce myeloid bias in terms of hematopoietic production. So these phenotypes, because they're measured at the level of the peripheral blood, can't necessarily be ascribed directly to changes in hematopoietic stem cells because there are many intermediates in between. So what we did to look at this was to take from these transplants, as I showed here, and re-isolate hematopoietic stem cells from these animals, donor-derived stem cells, and perform RNA-seq. And what we find is that in the middle age compared to the young, They have an increased expression of a lot of myeloid biased or any immune response signatures, consistent with this idea of myeloid bias at the level of the hematopoietic stem cell pool. Whereas if you take the middle-aged stem cells and have returned them back into a young recipient, you can see that this is reverted back. So you see a reduced expression of all of these signatures. So we think there's good evidence to suggest that the restoration of a young environment also can restore lineage balance at the level of the hematopoietic stem cell pool. So given that this data altogether argues for an important role of the bone marrow microenvironment, the HSC extrinsic context in causing aging phenotypes to emerge at middle age, we then wanted to explore the mechanisms, obviously, by which that does so. So we did, we gathered another set of RNA-seq data, and this was from non-transplant context, from young, middle-aged, and old animals, where we isolated and purified long-term hematopoietic stem cells. And as you can see from this principal component analysis, the middle-aged and old overlap somewhat, but are not completely overlapping, suggesting that there may be some unique signatures that we can drive and interrogate at middle age that might then be lost in the context of older age due to just more complex and processes occurring. So we interrogated this further, and we're looking for signatures that were specific or unique to middle age, uniquely enriched in middle age. And the major signature that came up is shown as this cluster of genes here. So these are things that are decreased at middle age specifically. Upon pathway analysis, enrichment analysis, we found that this predicted a decrease in mTOR, mTORC1 signaling, and metabolic signatures as being particularly relevant to middle age. I'll come back to this throughout the talk. So this was predicted to be a significant and important a signature or mechanism in this context. So we then took this data and also did an ingenuity pathway analysis to, in attempt to predict what might be upstream outside of the hematopoietic stem cell, growth factors, cytokines, molecules that might be causing this or predicted to cause these gene expression changes as I'm showing here. And so from that analysis, it essentially gives us a list of candidate upstream regulators that can be further interrogated and pursued functionally. And what we found striking was at the top of this list were two members of the insulin-like growth factor family, IGF-1 and IGF-2. This is showing p-values, so this is showing significance, but not directionality per se, whether it's up or down. However, the reason why we found this to be pretty compelling was in regards to what I just showed you previously, regulation of mTOR, mTORC signaling, as well as metabolic regulation is a very well understood to be downstream of the insulin-like growth factor molecules. And so these became very interesting candidates for us to continue to pursue and explore. And so what we did next was to ask where these molecules, IGF-1, IGF-2, are expressed in the context of cells in the bone marrow microenvironment, both hematopoietic and non-hematopoietic. And so this is a single cell RNA-seq data set that incorporates both hematopoietic as well as non-hematopoietic stromal cells within it. And you can see the transcript for IGF-1 on the left and IGF-2 on the right are most highly expressed and enriched in non-hematopoietic compartments. So they're expressed in mesenchymal populations, including adipocar cells, which have been described as a component of the hematopoietic stem cell niche, fibroblast populations, as well as endothelial cells. So this, this pathway and these molecules very nicely fit the model that the data were pointing us toward of factors that would be produced outside of the hematopoietic stem cell population and in the bone marrow microenvironment that then would have influence on the process of hematopoietic stem cell aging at middle age. And so we looked at the directionality of this change. And in fact, the IGF-1 was predicted to be decreased with aging and IGF-2 predicted to be increased with aging based on the gene expression data that I showed you. And so we interrogated that further by looking at the levels of these molecules by ELISA, looking at protein levels in the bone marrow fluid itself. So we took from young all the way through to old animals, and you can see that IGF-1, consistent with the prediction, was reduced in levels with aging, and this was already significant by middle age, which is fit with sort of our expectation from the data that I showed you previously. Whereas IGF-2 at the protein level, we found not to be significantly changed, increased or decreased. So this really renewed our focus on IGF-1 as potentially a key regulator of this process. And we chose that to continue to follow on with mechanistic studies. So the first study we decided to do was to ask whether decreased IGF-1 in the environment could be sufficient to cause HSC aging and hematopoietic aging phenotypes. So here we're taking wild-type hematopoietic cells and transplanting them into mice that have a conditional knockout of the IGF-1 transcripts. And this is using a sort of pan-expressing Cre recombinase. So this is not knocking out IGF-1 in any one particular compartment, but essentially in the entire mouse, including the microenvironment. So the only cells that will continue to have the potential to express IGF-1 are the hematopoietic cells that we transplant into these mice. So what we find is that in an IGF-1 knockout recipient, that we recapitulate hematopoietic aging phenotypes, here showing myeloid bias at the level of the peripheral blood. So increased myeloid cell and decreased B cell proportions. Now, IGF-1, as you may know, can be produced both systemically as well as locally in a tissue-specific context. So this experiment really knocked out IGF-1 everywhere throughout the mouse. And we wanted to dissect that a little bit further. The liver is the major systemic source of IGF-1. And so we next used recipients for transplants that had IGF-1 knockout driven by a nestin Cre transgene, which is expressed within components of the bone marrow microenvironment, as well as some cell types in the brain, but is not induced in liver. So this would allow us to sort of rule out the role of liver-derived IGF-1 in this process, or dissect that. So we transplanted wild-type hematopoietic stem cells into these recipient animals. And what we observed was something very similar, of aging-associated phenotype of myeloid-biased hematopoiesis. So increased myeloid production and decreased B-cell production from those wild-type hematopoietic stem cells that we transplanted into these animals. And we took it one step further by doing a secondary transplant just to interrogate whether this was truly a hematopoietic stem cell-derived phenotype. And we find that this phenotype is sustained in secondary transplants as well, secondary transplant recipients of a myeloid-biased hematopoiesis phenotype, increased myeloid and reduced B-cell chimerism. So taken together, this is really pointing us toward that loss of the IGF-1 in the bone marrow microenvironment is sufficient to induce myeloid bias hematopoiesis, which is a phenotype associated with aging. Now, the explanation for this could be direct, could be indirect. So if you're losing IGF-1 in the microenvironment, as I'm showing across the bottom here, there's the potential that that then affects other cell types in the microenvironment that has then an indirect effect on hematopoiesis. So we haven't proven here that it's in fact a direct effect. And so in order to interrogate that further, we decided to do the converse, which was to knock out the receptor, IGF-1 receptor, on the surface of the hematopoietic stem cells, and then transplant those into wild-type recipients and see if that could recapitulate the phenotypes that I just showed you. And the result was that it does. So in the primary transplant recipients, we see a myeloid-biased hematopoiesis, increased donor-derived myeloid cells, and decreased proportion of donor-derived B cells. So we interpreted this as evidence that there's a direct effect of IGF-1 signaling coming from the microenvironment that's necessary to support lineage balance coming from a hematopoietic stem cell, hematopoietic stem cells, and that this is relevant to the context of aging. So we then wanted to ask whether the concept of stimulating with IGF-1 of middle-aged hematopoietic stem cells might restore some of their functionality or reverse or reduce those hallmarks of aging that I've shown you previously. And so this first graph here is showing what happens when you stimulate long-term hematopoietic stem cells that have been isolated from middle-aged mice with IGF-1. This is looking at phosphorylation of the IGF-1 receptor. So this is to prove to you that long-term hematopoietic stem cells can respond to IGF-1 ligand by phosphorylation of the receptor. This is a very short-term, 15-minute stimulation with IGF-1. So we're confident that these are retained as a long-term hematopoietic stem cell population. They don't undergo cell division. What I'm not showing you, just in the interest of time, is that we can also show that phosphorylation of AKT is activated in a similar time frame. And we also see reduction in some of the molecular hallmarks of aging, like the gamma H2AX foci. What I want to spend the time to show you is the functional data, because I think ultimately that's the most important and the most convincing. So when we take long-term hematopoietic stem cells out of middle-aged mice and stimulate them with IGF-1 and then transplant them back into recipient animals, into aged recipient animals, what we see is that that IGF-1 stimulation is sufficient to reverse or revert some that myeloid bias to hematopoiesis phenotype and restore lymphoid potential to these cells. So this is shown here by a reduction in myeloid cell chimerism in the peripheral blood and increased B cell chimerism in the peripheral blood. And this is true also in the context of secondary recipients. So when you then remove those cells and transplant them again into a new set of recipients, and we see a sustained reduction in myeloid cell bias and increased, here showing B and T cells, so lymphoid chimerism from these cells. So we think that this demonstrates that IGF-1 does have utility in terms of restoring their lymphoid potential from hematopoietic stem cells in the context of aging, and especially at middle age, which is really where the focus of this work has been. To try to dissect now to some extent, the mechanism by which this is happening, we stimulated the middle age long-term HSCs with IGF-1 and then performed ATAC-seq as well as RNA-seq, which I'm not showing you here, to look at try to get a sense of the signatures or the mechanisms that might be restored or altered by IGF-1 stimulation of these cells. And what we see, the mTORC1 signature shouldn't surprise you because I just showed you the IGF-1 receptor signaling. So this is just kind of goes hand in hand with that. But we were really interested to see some signatures of metabolism emerge as sort of direct or close to direct targets of IGF-1 signaling in HSCs. And this really harkens back to what I showed you toward the beginning of my talk as being one of the major signatures that came out of the difference between young and middle-aged hematopoietic stem cells. And so we wanted to pursue this a little bit further. And we have done a few experiments related to mitochondrial function and mitochondrial metabolism. And I want to show you one of those that I think is a particularly striking demonstration. So this is looking at mitochondrial fragmentation phenotypes. So these images here are of purified long-term hematopoietic stem cells out of young or middle-aged mice. And these are mice that express this mitodendrite 2 reporter. So the green here is showing mitochondria, essentially stains mitochondria. And you can see that in young hematopoietic stem cells, there's a very nice elongated mitochondrial morphology and clear establishment of a network of connectivity between these mitochondria. If you look at long-term hematopoietic stem cells isolated from middle-aged animals, you can see that they are more punctate, round, morphology and do not have the same sort of connectivity across mitochondria. And this can really be quantitated by what's called mitochondrial sphericity, so essentially how round these individual mitochondria are. And you can see that they are significantly more spherical when you isolate long-term HSCs from middle age compared to young animals. And when we looked at this phenotype after short-term stimulation with IGF-1, so this is a 16-hour stimulation, you can see that in the vehicle-treated middle-aged long-term hematopoietic stem cells, you see a phenotype that's similar, spherical mitochondria. However, when you look at cells that have been stimulated with IGF-1, you can see a restoration of this elongated mitochondrial morphology and greater evidence for network connectivity between mitochondria. And this is quantitated here at the bottom. So this phenotype was of interest to us, this concept of mitochondrial function and mitochondrial potential and in the context of aging. And while we were pursuing these studies, in fact, another paper was published. This is work from Chirik Amver's group that made an observation and an association between mitochondrial morphology, mitochondrial potential, and lineage potential from hematopoietic stem cells. So what they show is that hematopoietic stem cells from old mice with dysfunctional mitochondria or less functional mitochondria, they're cute, have a myeloid bias in their differentiation potential in their transcriptional programs. And in the converse, in young hematopoietic stem cells with very healthy functioning mitochondria, that this goes part and parcel with their ability to be lineage balanced, with their ability to produce lymphoid progeny. And so we were interested to interrogate this sort of connection in our system and in response to IGF-1. And so the experiment that we set up was to take, these are long-term hematopoietic stem cells isolated from middle-aged mice, and we divided them up into cells that are hematopoietic stem cells that are myeloid biased versus lymphoid biased or lineage balanced. And the way we did this was to rely on the expression level of a marker called CD150, which has been described in literature by many groups as being able to segregate cells that are more myeloid biased versus cells that are more lymphoid biased or lineage balanced. And so this is essentially what we did. We took myeloid biased hematopoietic stem cells and lymphoid biased or lineage balanced hematopoietic stem cells, sorted out individual single cells into each well of several plates, and then stimulated them either with IGF-1 or in vehicle control. And we then assessed under the microscope the time to first cell division and then subsequent cell divisions that occurred in these cell within these cells. And what this what we found with this experiment is that myeloid biased HSC did not seem to be influenced by the presence of IGF-1 in terms of their time to first division or subsequent divisions, whereas the lymphoid biased or lineage balanced hematopoietic stem cells really were influenced by addition of IGF-1 and recombinant IGF-1, where they had a greater proportion of those cells had undergone an initial division by 18 hours. And if you keep following over time, are more likely to undergo subsequent divisions. So this isn't, of course, proof that these are retaining themselves in the hematopoietic stem cell state, but we think it's evidence that there is some selectivity in response of different subpopulations of HSCs to IGF-1. So this concept that the reduction in IGF-1 at middle age might be selecting for certain subpopulations of hematopoietic stem cells that are less reliant on the support of IGF-1. And I would say that those are likely to be myeloid biased HSCs, whereas lymphoid biased or lineage balanced HSCs may be more IGF-1 might be a more important factor and cytokine for those to be able to sustain themselves and potentially differentiate to give rise to lymphoid progeny. So to summarize the first part, what I've shown you is that the middle-aged bone marrow microenvironment, we think, regulates hematopoietic stem cell lineage composition and function. So the environment is as important or more important than the age of the hematopoietic stem cells themselves. And second, that the reduced IGF-1 at middle age is a cause of, it can be targeted to ameliorate myeloid bias hematopoiesis. And we think this relates to differing importance of IGF-1 for different subpopulations of hematopoietic stem cells. So moving on to the second part, I want to talk more briefly about some of our work relating to how we're thinking about preventing myeloid malignancies from being initiated from stem and progenitor cells. And I definitely don't need to show this slide to this audience, but I just wanted to get everybody on the same page that clonal hematopoiesis driving mutations are selected for with aging. And this is, of course, a very, very simplified a diagram, but conceptually, I think it's important to sort of introduce this. So aging is really a critical factor that is promoting and contributing to selection of clonal hematopoiesis driving mutations and potentially also selection of mutations that then result in transformation to MDS or AML. And what we have been thinking about in my lab is what are the mechanisms by which these clonal hematopoiesis mutations are selected for. There are at least two possibilities, the two that we think a lot about in my lab. One is that mechanistically that some of these clonal hematopoiesis mutations may either maintain or restore more youthful hematopoietic stem cell functionality and thereby allow those stem cells to outcompete hematopoietic stem cells that don't carry those mutations. The second is that there may be alterations in the microenvironment with aging or in the whole organism with aging that alters the selective pressure that may favor outgrowth or transformation of hematopoietic stem cells that carry some of these clonal hematopoiesis mutations. So I'll point out, and I'm sure you'll agree, those two are not mutually exclusive. So we cannot necessarily rule out one over the other, at least at this point with the data I'm going to show you. But I think the data that I'll show you really argues for the importance of the second, that can't be discounted. So before I get into the data, I need to tell you about the model. So first, we created a mouse model of common somatic DNMT3 mutation that's most commonly found in human de novo AML, this R882 missense mutation, which also is found in clonal hematopoiesis, but arguably less common. And the mouse model we created is the mouse equivalent, an R878H mutation. It's a knock-in, it's inducible, and inducible via Cre recombinase. And for the experiments that I'm going to show you today, we used an MX1 Cre recombinase to induce this mutant allele expression and to obtain the phenotypes that I'll talk about. So what happens in these DNMT3 mutant animals? We see an HSC expansion. And our data are most consistent with this being mediated by enhanced self-renewal and somewhat limited differentiation capacity of those hematopoietic stem cells. So this is showing the data wild type versus DNMT3A mutant that we see an increase in proportion of hematopoietic stem cells in the bone marrow of these mice and that this occurs over time. It's obviously not immediate upon induction. It occurs over time and age. That if you look at the transcriptional patterns within mutant hematopoietic stem cells early on, they have reduced expression of many genes associated with hematopoietic differentiation. So they seem to not have an upregulation of genes that would be important for them to be able to differentiate. And that when we look at transplantation in primary transplants into recipient animals, we most often observe that the mutant hematopoietic stem cells have higher chimerism within the hematopoietic stem cell compartment than they do within the circulating peripheral blood compartment, as shown here. So that to us is most consistent with a model that they are able to outcompete wild type hematopoietic stem cells because they're better at self-renewal. They maintain themselves in the stem cell state through division. Although clearly they're not completely blocked in differentiation capacity, or you would not see them in contributing to the blood at all. So that's the phenotype. And we wanted to understand how this phenotype might influence susceptibility to transformation, particularly toward myeloid malignancies. We've never seen in these DNMT3A mutant animals that they sort of spontaneously develop leukemias. And so we knew that we needed to have a cooperating leukemia-driving oncogene to be able to evaluate transformation potential of these cells. And so for that purpose, we developed a second mouse model of an NPM1C mutation. So as you all I'm sure well know, NPM1 is frequently co-occurring in de novo AML, according to TCGA and many, many other studies. And we created a mouse model of the human equivalent of NPM1 mutation. And this is also an inducible knock-in mutant model. We generated it or designed it to be independently inducible. So this is inducible using FLIP recombinase rather than Cre recombinase. That was intentional so that we could interrogate how modulating effects on the DNMT3A mutant model might then change susceptibility to transformation mediated by NPM1. Hopefully that makes sense. And the DNMT3A mice, as I said, we don't see evidence for sort of spontaneous development of leukemias in these animals. If you leave the DNMT3A mutant mice on the shelf for long enough, some of them do develop myelodysplastic syndrome-like phenotypes, but not of leukemias per se. However, when you add the NPM1 mutation onto the DNMT3A mutation, and these in this experiment, they were induced a couple of months apart from each other, you do see all of the mice succumb to disease, and it's a most, you know, the best description is a myeloproliferative disorder in the context of these, in the context of mouse models. If you take those bone marrow samples and transplant them into secondary recipient animals, those animals die very quickly, and they die of a phenotype that resembles a more full-blown AML. Phenotype is shown here. So we think that this represents a progression from a mutation that gives hematopoietic stem cells a selective advantage all the way through to a leukemia phenotype. So one of the observations that we made in our initial report from the lab, when we wanted to understand how having the DNMT3A mutation for longer periods of time may influence the susceptibility to transformation by NPM1. We set up this experiment where we transplanted mice with DNMT3A mutant cells and then waited varying lengths of time before giving them tamoxifen, which is what induces the NPM1 mutation. So you can imagine this as having, you know, DNMT3A mutation and then 3 weeks later, an NPM1 mutation versus at the bottom here, DNMT3 mutation, and then over a year later, an NPM1 mutation. And what we find reported from this experiment is that when you do that, the time between getting the NPM1 mutation and developing disease is much faster when you've had the DNMT3 mutation around for a long time, more than a year. And this is, again, measured from the time of NPM1 mutation to death of the animals. So this is pretty striking to us. However, there are limitations in interpreting this data because we cannot dissect the difference between latency and age. So by waiting 57 weeks before giving tamoxifen, these mice are obviously much, much older when the NPM1 mutation is induced compared to the mice at the top of this picture here. So we wanted to be able to try to design experiments to be able to dissect that latency versus aging, because I think it is a really critical variable to be able to understand in terms of the mechanism of how DNMT3A may or may not be predisposing to myeloid malignancy. So for it is a relatively new experiment that we've done in the lab, where we've taken the DNMT3A mutant and NPM1 mutant bone marrow. At least these are from animals that have the potential for those mutations, but they haven't been induced yet. And we, in order to interrogate as a single factor the role of the aging bone marrow microenvironment in this process, we thought that was actually kind of one of the easiest places to start in terms of dissecting out relevant variables. We transplanted these into young or middle-aged animals. These were treated with busulfan as a conditioning regimen rather than irradiation, because we were concerned about confounding effects of irradiating an old bone marrow microenvironment on these phenotypes. And so we transplanted, 4 weeks later, induced the DNMT3 mutation, and then 16 weeks later, induced the NPM1 mutation. So the only difference between these is really the age of these animals. Otherwise, the age of the hematopoietic stem cells, the length of time with the mutations is all controlled for. That's all the same. So what we observe when we transplant these into young versus aged, so the age is in pink, is the arrow here indicates the time of the NPM1 mutation being induced. And so you can see shortly after induction of the NPM1 mutation, we see an increase in the peripheral blood chimerism of the double mutant cells in the aged mice compared to the young mice. And this really represents myeloid chimerism, not lymphoid chimerism. So myeloid expands quite rapidly in the older animals compared to the younger animals. And at the time, at the end of this experiment, at the time of sacrifice of these mice, it is only in the older animals that we see development of a more of fulminant leukemia phenotype. So these are peripheral blood smears from young versus age, which are pretty clear that the aged environment is really promoting selection for these mutant cells in such a way that it seems to be accelerating the transformation of these cells. So our conclusion here is that, like the first part of my talk, that the aged bone marrow microenvironment is actually really a critical part, at least in these mouse models, of going from DNMT3A mutation to transformation. And to start to get a hint at the mechanism, and I'm just going to give you a little preview of this for today, is that we have been focusing on the DNMT3A mutant hematopoietic stem cell context. And these are, this is a RNA-seq data taken from DNMT3A mutant versus control hematopoietic stem cells, where they were both isolated out of aged recipients. So this is a transplant experiment where it's young stem cells into old mice and then back out of old mice. And when you look, there are a lot of differentially expressed genes between them. And when you do this type of pathway analysis, like I told you before, ingenuity pathway analysis to predict upstream regulators, there are a number of factors that are predicted to be different, more activated in the context of mutant stem cells compared to wild type stem cells out of the same environment. So this suggests that the DNMT3 mutant HSCs are responding in a way that's distinct to factors in the aged environment. And so these are some of the factors. These are not going to surprise anybody, pro-inflammatory molecules, but these are some of the factors that we're now exploring in really in-depth functional mechanistic experiments in the lab. And hopefully in a year or two, I can come to Boston in person and share with you the results of all of those studies. So for the second part of my talk, what I've told you is that the aged bone marrow microenvironment exerts a positive selection pressure for outgrowth of DNMT3 mutant cells and seems to accelerate transformation. And we think this really serves as a platform for a mechanistic interrogation. And our hope is that we will be able to identify things that then can be considered for more translational types of experiments to sort of move this as appropriate forward to benefit people, hopefully one day. So I want to leave you with a piece of art that we had commissioned that I think well sort of describes the higher level or illustrates the higher level of this work. And this is inspired by Edward Hopper's Cape Cod Morning, which is shown on the left. And on the right is sort of our version. So what this I'd like to try to illustrate to you all is the importance of the environment. So decline and poor function, or a declining capacity of the environment that surrounds you is clearly going to have a negative impact on you and a negative impact on your hematopoietic stem cells. So with that, I'd like to thank the people in my lab that contributed to this work. The first part of the talk was really the work of Kira Young, who's a research scientist in my lab. And the second part is a cooperative work between Jen San Miguel, a postdoc, and Liz Udy, who's a research assistant in the lab. And the collaborators, Rebecca Schneider and Mike Rao, with the histopathology, Ross Levine, who helped us to do a lot of targeted sequencing, which I didn't talk about in my talk, but I'm happy to talk about afterward or offline. Marie-Dominique Philippi, who collaborated on the mitochondria and metabolism work, and Simon Haas, who's our collaborator for single-cell RNA-seq. Thank you all very much for your attention and happy to take questions.
Thank you, Dr. Trowbridge, for a great talk. I just want to remind everyone to submit your questions in the Q&A icon down at the bottom of your screen. I see we have a bunch of questions already, so I'll read them out. So the first is from Dr. Lachelle Weeks, who asks, do the DNMT3A mice who develop MDS or myeloid neoplasms acquire additional mutations or cytogenetic abnormalities?
Great question. We have not interrogated cytogenetic abnormalities, but I'm interested to do so. I can speak to mutations, and we assess this based on sort of a targeted sequencing panel. This was in collaboration with Ross at Memorial Sloan Kettering. We used their M-Impact panel. So what we find is that the mutations acquired in the context of DNMT3A mutation as a single induced mutation are limited, actually. We see a pretty good evidence of genomic stability, actually, in those clones. So lack of evidence of major variants that are acquired or accrued to a high level. It's a different story once you have acquired an NPM1 mutation. So with the NPM1 mutation, we then see other cooperating alleles emerge and selected for, particularly once we get to a phenotype that looks like an AML phenotype. There are many cooperating mutations, including in genes like NF1, CBL, and then on occasion, we also see other epigenetic regulators, IDH1, IRID, et cetera.
Thank you. Next question is from Dr. Van Galen, who asks whether you think the increasing susceptibility of DNMT3A mutant HSCs to myeloid transformation over time is due to the accumulation of epigenetic changes in the HSCs themselves.
That's a great question. Thank you, Peter. We have looked at this. We've done a TACSeq actually on purified populations of hematopoietic stem cells and also progenitor cells. And to be honest with you, we see a lot more changes at the level of progenitor cells rather than at the level of stem cells. And there are technical reasons why that could be the case in our you know, quality of the libraries and the depth of sequencing is often harder to do from really rare stem cell populations, as you know. But there isn't yet strong evidence to suggest massive sort of chromatin reorganization at the level of hematopoietic stem cells. We have yet to really do that over time. So that, I think that's a great question. That's something that we are and will be continuing to pursue.
The next question is from Dr. Gularia, excuse my pronunciation. Was there any change in anti-inflammatory cytokines such as TGF-beta, IL-10, et cetera, in the mutants, and any changes in T-cell types such as decreased Tregs or other altered immune cell number and function?
Yeah, that's a great question. We do see, trying to recall the data thoroughly, we have seen evidence for alterations of some of those anti-inflammatory cytokines that you mentioned, like TGF-beta. In terms of the directionality, I think there are, it's context specific, so there are some cases where it is observed and some cases where it is not. In the context of aging, those seem to be signatures that emerge much more strongly when you look at wild-type hematopoietic stem cell aging compared to when you look at DNMT3 mutant hematopoietic stem cell aging. So that may indirectly answer your question. In terms of the phenotype of T cells, that's something we have not done in depth. I think it's a very intriguing question, and always happy to, I should mention this in my talk, always happy to collaborate with anybody to interrogate these models or share these models. So please reach out to me anytime if you'd like to explore that further.
Next question, and I think I'll jump onto this one as well from Dr. Bauer. So I'll ask the first part of the question is, what sort of conditioning did you use in the first experiments of young and middle-aged reciprocal transplantation? And then secondarily, as Dr. Bauer is asking, how much does or could the differential response to conditioning based on age influence the outcomes of these experiments?
Yeah, that's a really important question. So in those first set of reciprocal transplantation experiments, those were done using radiation, certainly. Those experiments were actually done a very long time ago in our lab. We have subsequently repeated many of those experiments, either using a sublethal conditioning or busulfan conditioning. And it's not exactly the same, but it's not completely different. So I think the higher level conclusions are preserved, even with those alternative conditioning regimens. Why? I suspect that there is a much, much greater effect when you're working with very old mice, which I'll remind you all that for many of these transplant experiments, we're using middle-aged mice, and we often transplant them when they're 9 to 10 months of age. So they're not so different from young mice. I mean, obviously, for all the data I showed you, they're different. But in terms of the conditioning dose and the effect of that on the microenvironment, we have not seen very, very dramatic differences in terms of their response to conditioning. If I were to do these experiments on old mice, I definitely would not use an irradiation conditioning approach for that reason, that I think it is fundamentally very different. But I also think that there's probably something you can learn there by exploring what actually changes in response to irradiation and then what's necessary for regeneration.
Thanks. And then I think we have time for one more question from Dr. Brunner. Have you modulated IGF-1 in the DNMT3 NPM1 model itself?
We're doing it. I think that's the place where everybody in my lab wants to go. Obviously, I set that up for some future talks. I would love to talk to you about that. So we do see a phenotype, and we do see that good evidence so far that this metabolic changes and mitochondrial metabolism are going to be a major part of clonal hematopoiesis and transformation phenotypes. So we're really excited to get into that.
Thanks. And so I'd like to thank you, Dr. Trowbridge, for coming to Boston and and giving us this fantastic lecture. I'd also like to thank the Edward P. Evans Foundation for supporting the MDS Center here at Dana-Farber, as well as for this seminar series in myelodysplastic syndromes. Our next seminar will be in the fall, and so we invite you all to return then. So thanks again, Dr. Trowbridge, for your talk, and I'm sure you'll be receiving some requests for collaboration in the near future.
Wonderful. Thank you all very much.